Jesus, take me, mold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh, Jesus, take me, mold and make me. I yield my life. My God, you're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. So Jesus, take me, mold and make me. I yield my life. Jesus, take me, mold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh, Jesus, take me, mold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh, God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. So Jesus, take me, hold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh, Jesus, take me, mold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh, Jesus, take me, mold and make me. Yield my life to you. Oh God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God, you're all I want, all I desire. Yes, sir.
Is the name and the power of the name Jesus, Lord Jesus. Almighty is the name, the glorious name. Oh, how glorious, oh, how wonderful are these rivers. Are these rivers of life, oh God? Oh, how glorious. Oh, how wonderful. Is this so great a salvation? Is this so great of salvation? Oh, how glorious. Oh, how wonderful is this unspeakable gift? Is this unspeakable gift? Hallelujah. Oh, how glorious. Oh, how wonderful is the mighty name. Is the mighty name of Jesus. Oh, how glorious. Oh, how wonderful is the mighty name, is the mighty name of Jesus. Oh, how glorious. Oh, how wonderful is this so great, is this so great of salvation. Oh, how glorious. Oh, how wonderful is this unspeakable gift. Is this unspeakable gift. Lord, we praise you. Lord, we praise you. We worship you. We worship you in spirit and in truth. In spirit, Lord, and in your truth. Hallelujah. Oh, how glorious. Oh, how wonderful is the mighty name. Is the mighty name of Jesus. Every knee shall bow. Every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Almighty God. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Almighty God. He's the Alpha, the Omega. Every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Almighty God. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Almighty God. The Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, and He is the end. The Alpha, the Omega, He is the first and He is the last. And every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess. mute will sing. The lame will leap just like a deer at play. Water shall pour forth from the wilderness and springs in the midst of a dry land. Because of Jesus, because of Jesus Christ, because of Jesus Christ, the Almighty God, every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is the Almighty God. Every knee shall bow, every tongue Christ is the Almighty God, the name above all names, King above all kings. His name shall bring forth the will of God. The lame shall leap as a deer at play. The tongue of the dumb shall sing by his name. Where a wilderness existed, the paradise of God shall spring forth from the waters of the Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Almighty God. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess Jesus Christ is Almighty God. God will prove himself, and by his own might and power will make known the name that he is sanctified. God will prove himself, and by his own power he'll make known the name that he is sanctified. The name of Jesus, the name of Jesus, the name of Jesus Christ, it raises up the dead. The name of Jesus, the name of Jesus Christ, the name of Jesus that raises up the dead. The lame will walk like the deer at play. Tongue of the mute, it will sing. The lame shall leap. The lame shall leap like the deer at play. The tongue of the mute, it will sing. Jesus, the name of Jesus, the name of Jesus Christ, Almighty God. The name of Jesus, the mighty name of Jesus, the name of Jesus that raises up the dead. Ah, come on. The name of Jesus. Woo! The mighty name of Jesus. The name of Jesus that raises up the dead. The name of Jesus. The mighty name of Jesus. The name of Jesus Christ that raises up the dead. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Almighty God. So go, Ipoyo. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Almighty God. And my knees they bow, and my tongue confesses, Jesus Christ is Almighty God. God will prove himself. God will prove himself. He shall make known. He shall make known the name that he is sanctified. The name that he is sanctified. God will prove himself. He shall make known. He shall make known the name that he is sanctified. By the name of Jesus Christ, every devil has to flee. New tongues that have never been heard shall men speak. Water shall be a flood in the wilderness, and the desert shall spring forth springs, and the lame shall leap as a deer at play. The tongue of the mute will sing songs of praise and worship to the King. For redemption has come and life has entered in, and the light now shines in the midst of the darkness. Everyone can see that God has redeemed all things, and every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Almighty God. Jesus, Jesus Christ is Lord. Every knee shall bow. Every tongue confess. Jesus Christ is Almighty God. God will prove himself. He shall make known the name that he has sanctified. God will prove himself. The world will see. The world will see a great salvation light, a great salvation light. Oh, great and mighty is the Lord of hosts. He will bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ is Almighty God. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess, that Jesus Christ is Almighty God. And my knees I bow, and my knees I bow, God, and with my tongue confess, O Lord, that Jesus Christ is Almighty God. He's sovereign King. You're sovereign King. You're the Alpha and Omega, Alpha and Omega, eternal God, the everlasting Lord, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus Christ, the name that raises up the dead, he is Jesus, hallelujah. Jesus Christ, Jesus is the name that raises up the dead. Resurrection, my resurrection. Oh God, the God of my salvation. Resurrection, my resurrection, my resurrection. The name, the God of my salvation, the resurrection, and the life, resurrection, the name that raises up the dead. The resurrection, my resurrection in my life, my resurrection in my life. The name that raises up the dead. The resurrection, my resurrection in my life, my resurrection in my life. The name that raises up the dead. The resurrection, hallelujah. The resurrection and the life. The name that raises up the dead. The resurrection, my resurrection. My resurrection and my life. The name that raises up the dead. Soto, sito, papayo. The resurrection. My resurrection and my life. The name that raises up the dead. Hallelujah. Jesus. Jesus. Hallelujah. Every knee shall bow. Every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is the Almighty God. Every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is the Almighty God. The resurrection, the resurrection, my resurrection. My resurrection and my life. Jesus Christ who raises up the dead. The resurrection. My resurrection and my life. Jesus Christ who raises up the dead. Woohoo! Father, we thank you for your signs and your wonders. We thank you for the display of the powerful name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father God, for the display of the glory that you've given to your only begotten Son. The resurrection, ha ha ha, my resurrection and my life. The resurrection, hallelujah, my resurrection and my life. Jesus Christ who raises out of the dead. The resurrection. My resurrection and my life. Jesus Christ who raises out of the dead. And though my flesh should turn into dust, yet shall I be revived, and yet shall I live again, for I know that my Redeemer lives and stands upon the earth in the last day. The resurrection. Jesus Christ, King. Hallelujah. The resurrection, my resurrection, my resurrection and my life. Jesus Christ who raises up the dead. And the Lord himself shall descend with the voice of an archangel and the sound of the trumpet, and the dead in Christ shall rise. And we which are alive and remain shall be caught up to meet him in the air, to forever be with the Lord. My resurrection, my resurrection and my life, Jesus Christ. The resurrection, the resurrection, my resurrection, my resurrection. Woohoo! Jesus Christ who raises out the dead. Resurrection, my resurrection and my life, Jesus Christ, to raise his own dead. Well, you know, it's amazing to me that a lot of the church don't like to sing songs like that. It's the only kind I like to even sing. Of course, they only come as a result of singing in the Spirit. So reality of it is, I guess you just got to get used to it. Got to get used to the things God's doing instead of what man's doing. People so fixated on what men are doing. But all flesh is grass, all the glory of men is the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower thereof fades away. But something's going to endure forever. Something's going to endure forever. Something. There's a powerful authority in the Word of God who was made flesh. The eternal Word who came and dwelt among us. The living Word expressing every part of the written Word, Christ Jesus. Oh, the Word that brought forth the heavens, established the earth. The Word that framed all things. The Word who spoke life, and you and I came forth as a new creation. Hallelujah. 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 Naye ayosuya tanade hilo minanera sibiterai hoku mamra mandulu ngila numo. See, the Spirit of the Lord was poured out upon all flesh, not just a few men, prophets to prophesy, judges to rule, to command the sun and the moon to stand still, to speak forth the word of authority and power, but to be poured out upon anyone who would receive. And on the day that the church was born, on the day that the Holy Ghost was given, which is the reason why Christ Jesus' body was torn as a veil, so that men could enter into a realm where only God dwells, the one who is unchanging, immutable, who dwells in a light which no man can approach unto, neither has anyone ever seen before, so that we could enter into this glory place with power and authority. Now, Christ Jesus' flesh and his body was ripped to pieces, rent in two, that we might be saved and born again by the same miracle power of the Holy Ghost. But Father also supplied something that goes beyond just the life of Jesus. He also supplied the privilege of you and I stepping into the ministry of Jesus. He gave to us the Spirit of truth. He gave to us this wonderful regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost that's found in this beautiful and glorious redemption we call salvation. The Father also gave to us the ability, the power, and the authority to stand beyond that which was given to the disciples when the Lord Jesus gave them all power and authority against over all diseases and sicknesses to cure them. He said all, not some, but all. That's what God said. Men want to have the word according to what they believe in their experiences rather than stepping over into a realm that the word of God declares to be reality, to step over into an existence that goes beyond the seen into the realms of the unseen, from that which is temporal into that which is eternal, that which is natural into that which is superior to the natural. And this is the challenge that men are faced with, whether or not they're going to walk in agreement and belief with what God said, whether they're going to allow the Word of God to build them up and give them an inheritance among all the saints that are in the light, hallelujah, which no man can see nor has approached unto. Men fail and men fall short, and men allow fiery darts to enter into the realms of their spirit that burns up all the truth of God and turns them into ashes simply because they've not allowed the water of the Word to cover their life as the water that covers the sea. They've not allowed the Word of God to reign supreme in their spirit. They've been unwilling to have the 2020 vision that God has supplied. Believe the Lord and you shall be established. Believe the Lord and you shall be established. Hearken unto the voice of the prophet and so shall you prosper. Second Chronicles 20:20 and give you 20:20 vision. I hope you, if you don't know it, I hope you get it. You know, the thing about it is I don't think that Father could have used, well, there's a couple of other really good examples, but it's a highlighted example to us of how the Father has purposed us to walk in an unseen realm rather than a seen, because Jehoshaphat has got news that those who are coming with the chariots invented by the Hittites, who had wheels basically with, you know, double-edged swords, are out to take them down, and they're looking for some encouragement from the Lord, an ally to help them fight, some kind of insight to how they're going to strategically overthrow the superior army. And the prophet of the Lord says, today you go out and you will sing to them. You're going to sing the sweet songs of the Spirit. And I mean, come on, you know, you think, well, you know, that isn't much. Well, when your life is at risk, you get to find out whether or not you're going to agree with God's word, or you're going to listen to all the doubt and all the unbelief, because if the mixture comes, it will prevent God's word from being established in your life. To have a strong defense in who Christ Jesus is. He is the word. People are always asking me from a theological perspective, you know, to prove different things. And, you know, for me, it's very simple. If Jesus did it, if he lived it, if he showed it, then that is exactly what God's purpose for us. If he did not do it, if he did not live it, if he did not show us, it by example, because he's the living word. And he came in the volume of the book, the entire book, from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21. It's all written of him. God put on display all that Father has willed, all that Father has purposed, all that Father wants, all that we can do, all that we have, all the authority, all the power, all the life. Just think about this for just a minute. Think about it. Our lives, when God created Adam and Eve, he created them in a paradise, in a garden of plenty, of every good and perfect thing, of all the fruits that belong to the realms of who Papa is and who Father in his life is expressed to be. But through sin and iniquity, men's life became as a wilderness. It became as a total desert, a desolate wilderness, an empty place that was waste and desolate. Tahu babahu is the Hebrew phrase for it. Tahu babahu. Pretty easy to pronounce, right? At any rate, empty and waste. Huh? That's what it would look like. See, when Moses is giving to us the story, as it were, of creation, he's talking in terms of redemption. Is it real? True, it's real. It's literal. But he's talking in terms of redemption. It's all about redemption. He's expressing these things to us by the Spirit of the Lord. And that's why when you take Genesis chapter 1 through 3, you can actually, in many other respects, especially if you look at it in the Septuagint Greek, and then look at John, the Gospel of John, first chapter of the Gospel of John, which in the Greek, you could see how it's superimposed upon each other. Talking to us about redemption. You know, God created something so beautiful and so wonderful when he created man and formed in his image and his likeness and gave to him all that he had and put all of his works and all that he had brought forth in display of his creation under his feet. And here the life of God is being displayed in a terrestrial earthly body. Amazing. But that became a wilderness and a desolate empty place. And there is only one way. There's only one way for the wilderness to have floods of water again. Isaiah 35:6. You know, I want you to listen to this because it's very important. You know, when Paul was preaching, you know, one time, Paul usually was just preaching from what we would refer to as the Old Testament. Because he was in the process of writing the New Testament and it got around yet. Are you listening to me? In his audience, all they had, they didn't have any scrolls. But if the rabbi came to the meeting, he had a scroll and he could verify. But that's what he was doing. Probably by the time that the Apostle Paul was by his bar mitzvah at about 12, 13 years old, he would have clearly been able to quote with a reasonable kind of intellect among the Jewish people. He would have been able to have quoted all of the law, the five books. He would have been able to quote all the law. But more than likely, he would have been able to quote the law and the prophets. And hallelujah, true, because that's what it was about. That's what school was about. And you know, when you're whole and you're in part of in belonging to a people in covenant with God, you're just whole. You're not all. You don't got all the confusion going on inside of your head that keeps you from being able to remember what you just read. Oh my, when the Spirit of the Lord floods your spirit and your being, the intellect goes to an all-time high. And somebody says, help my memory. Come over here. Let me lay hands on you. Let me call forth floods, rivers, streams in the desert place. Hallelujah. A lot of people don't want it. I ask people all the time, you baptized in the Holy Ghost? Yes. Oh, so let me hear the Spirit. Let me hear the Holy Ghost pray through you. Let me hear the Holy Ghost speak. Well, what do you mean? That's what I'm talking about on the day of Pentecost when they were all gathered together in one place. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind. And clothed in tongues of fire came and rested upon each one of them. And they all began to speak with other tongues as the Holy Spirit gave them utterance. Oh, no, that hasn't happened to me. Hey, you can't tell me that you've been swimming when you aren't wet. Hello. Hello. I'm not talking about salvation. I'm talking about there's floods of power and divine authority. Even in salvation, there's a wellspring springing. Come on, there's a sobatore na casta comes as a power and an authority begins to flood out of us. And folks, Father has purposed to do this, to work out this wonderful display of the new creation through the wellspring and the wonderful display of his power and authority through our life by the expression of divine rivers. Listen, Father could not have said in any way, he could have not expressed baptism in his glory with more perfect example than to describe it is the unlimited flow of rivers. Have you ever watched a big river dry up? You're never gonna see, and this is a bad example, but the Snake River, okay, is never gonna dry up. If it dries up, the end of the world has come. Huh? We can talk about there's a lot of great rivers. It's just never gonna dry up. And the Lord didn't say river, he didn't say spring, he didn't say creek. Father has given you and I an entrance into a realm now where you and I can be built up by his word and by the Spirit to step into all the realms of the inheritance that he has supplied for us through the new creation. Somebody said, well, God has done this work to where now, you know, we've been restored back to where Adam was before he fell. No, it's not true. We've been restored to a place far greater. We've been restored, redeemed, and brought to a place far greater. No. If Adam would have never failed, okay, and you just draw not a linear relationship, but an exponential curve. Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
Of walking this out with God for 6,000 years, okay? Right? Walking it out with God in his image, in his likeness, in his glory, walking out with God for 6,000 years, Father did something even better. And he never missed a point, and we found ourselves right there at that place, which is huge. Huh? Huge. Huge. Huge, huge display of the power of God. Because Father recreated us in the person, Christ Jesus, the eternal living God. The eternal living God. And we want to be something less. Because we've had religion rather than relationships. We had ideology rather than the Word of God. People are constantly replacing the experience of what's going on in their life with what God has declared in his Word. Amen. It's laying the whole of his word. I mean, there are sometimes we go to places where, you know, at the end of the meeting, people are like, they're in shock because of all the signs and wonders and miracles. They're just in shock. And then we go to other places where it doesn't seem like anything happened. And now they're just the opposite. He doesn't have the goods, right? Somebody said, well, what if it were always just like that, where you pray for people and do what God said in his word to do, and nobody got healed, nobody got saved, nobody got delivered, we would not change a thing. Because it has nothing to do with any frame of reference of our own intellect or opinion or perception. It is simply doing what God has told us to do, and at the end, we are all unprofitable servants. We simply know whether I have to stand in the midst of the fire of everybody having a bad attitude, or whether I have to stand in the midst of the fire of everybody with their praises and their, huh?
And everybody, people, you have to understand. And I'm going to talk to you about this morning. We all have different levels of responsibility. When we go to places that have never heard the gospel preached before or know nothing about the power of God, it's easy to see signs and wonders and miracles and see people get healed. They have very little responsibility. All the responsibility rests upon the shoulder of those who are moving in the authority and faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. But then we go to places where people have been studying the Word all their life, and they still haven't had a miracle. They still got more doubt than they've got faith. They got more unbelief than they, huh? Come on, listen to me. Faith lays hold on something. It has it. It possesses it. It's theirs. You'll let somebody convince you that your feet are not your feet, that they belong to someone else? Of course not. It's yours. What are you talking about? You crazy, man. Are you out of your mind? This is my feet. It's test of my body. What are you talking about? So the Word of God, so the life of God, so the things of the Spirit, they affix to me like my fingers, like my eyes, like my tongue, like my lips, like my toes. They're mine. God gave them to us. We need to possess them. You know, I've heard so many men of God say over and over again, and to talk about the responsibility that we have as we grow in God, as we're supposed to grow in God. We're supposed to grow right. We're supposed to understand how to grow right. We have to understand that the Word of God can't have a mixture with all of our opinions that are based upon this thing and that thing and the other thing. It's based upon experience. Experience is extremely fallible. In fact, it's the realm of deception. Better be careful. It's a realm of deception. The Word of God. There is no deception there. It's truth. The Word is the sanctifying power. Sanctify them through thy truth, O God. Your Word is truth. Hallelujah. You can sit down. Maybe some of you are tired. I'm about ready to run around like Joshua did last week. I mean, he jumped so high. I thought we might have to. Is he going to come down? Hallelujah! Are you happy?
Yes.
If you're not, we got your solution. If you're not happy, we have your solution. The joy of the Lord, Jesus. Told this to us by his servant John and also by his servant Paul, that he wrote these things to us. The Word of God is written to us that you read it and you believe it so that your joy can be complete, full. And then, you know, he's getting us prepared. Listen, he's getting us prepared for a joy that goes even beyond that. So just try to figure that out. This is fullness of joy, and he's getting us prepared to enter into the glory of our rest. The fullness of joy. Now, listen, the Lord's ministry is, the Lord's ministry, of course, you know, we understand that Jesus was anointed with the oil of gladness, the oil of joy, which is connected with being anointed with the Holy Ghost and power above everybody else. And we've stepped into that. Amen. Well, you're supposed to have stepped into that. If you read the Word of God and believe the Word of God, those things will ultimately result in your joy being full because everything you have need of will be being supplied. Hey, many are the afflictions of the righteous. Hey, there's going to be tribulations everywhere, but be good cheer.
Yeah.
You know what? You know what be good cheer means?
Yes.
Does anybody know what it looks like to be of good cheer?
Yes.
It looks like Pentecost. It's like you're drunk in the Holy Ghost. You got fullness of joy. There's a wellspring springing. There's a river flowing. Come on. This is what Father has ordained for you and I to have. But these things are only going to come to us because we're willing to step over in an entirely different dimension of living, not level, dimension. Dimension. It's not level to level. That's mysticism. People get, I'm not going to fault anybody for semantics, but you know, somebody said, should we concern ourselves with semantics? I said, yeah, from the perspective of you want the vocabulary of the Word of God.
Yes. Amen.
And then we have no problem. The vocabulary of the Word of God is going to produce within us right thinking.
Yes.
Right thinking is going to produce within us right behavior. Right thinking is going to produce within our lives the expression of God's manifest power and glory. And if there's anything I want to help you understand here this morning by the Spirit of the Lord is that you want to become saturated with the Word of God. You want to desire the sincere milk of the Word, or rather, it's really, it should be translated, you want to desire the sincere, the pure, the true nurturing nurturing of the Word of God, huh? That you may grow thereby. I understand why the translator says sincere milk, because it is, you know, if you, it's kind of a bit of a loose translation there, but it is talking about newborn babes, and so newborn babes live off of the sincere or the true nourishment, okay, of a baby is milk. And so it's fine. Butter and honey shall eat.
Yes.
Eh? Butter, that's some good solid milk. That's some good churned up cream, eh? Are you with me? Huh? That it may learn to choose the good and refuse evil. And what is that about? What is that really about? That's about saying yes to everything that God said in His Word. Everything. Satan and all the hordes of hell fight against the reality and the glory and the purity and the splendor and the power and the authority of the Word. Oh, my. What happens when all of a sudden you want the Word of God to rule you? To rule you. Many people today, I'll give you an example, many people today believe what CNN is saying. Worse Fox. And all the spin doctors and all the opinions of men, and we become idolizers of human flesh, of humanity, of people, of culture, of nationality. You know, big thing now, big movement now in the United States of America. Are you a nationalist or a globalist? I mean, all these people define themselves, you know, of these different things. I was talking to a guy last night who'd been in war in Iraq and had been in war in Afghanistan. I said, yeah. I said to him, Kashmir, it's like my home. He gets big eyes and he says, what are you talking about? I said, nobody's allowed to go to Kashmir. I said, I am. He said, what? And he's looking at me through the rearview mirror because it's the guy who picked me up in the lift, you know. And he's looking at me like, is this guy lying? What is this guy saying? You can't go to Kashmir. No. I don't come with a Western civilization mindset. I don't come with a culture of humanity. I come with the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God, a display of His love and His power and of His glory. He said, how can you go to these places and remain safe? How can I go to these places and remain safe? No problem. You ever heard about Job? He had this like little hedge of God around him. Satan couldn't touch him. Couldn't touch him. Huh? Are you listening to me? I mean, you know what? I'm telling you right now. To live is Christ. To die is gain. It's promotion. Hallelujah. It is so wonderful and so glorious to be able to live out this life of the kingdom of God that is described to us by the Word of God and by the Word of God only. And continually, you and I are being challenged as to whether or not we're going to believe God's Word, because all of the statistics and all the facts are going to oppose God's Word.
True.
We'll oppose it. Yeah. And you're going to go through the fiery trial of faith.
Amen.
A fiery furnace of faith. To see whether or not you're going to end up believing God's Word. Huh? Or the experience has come to defy His Word. Give me something, I'll take your head from off your shoulders. This day shall I give your flesh to the fowls of the air and the beasts of the field. To try to defy the Word of God, the people of the mighty God, the people, the host of the Lord Most High. Mm-hmm. Come on. That's who we are, as the people that are born of the Word. I was begotten of the Word. He beget me through the Word of truth. James said it, 1:18. Right? I've been begotten by the Word of God. I've been born of the Word. Peter said the same thing. What is it? 1 Peter? Is it 1 Peter 1:23 or is it 1:24? I pray that the Word is upon your lips. His Word is on your lips. See, if you begin to give yourself over to the Word of God will work effectually in them to believe. What is 1 Thessalonians 2:13? Effectually. Energeia, or from the word energo, which you could say, you could translate it as it sounds. Energeia. What? What does that sound like?
Energy.
Particular kind of energy. It's a river energy. It's divine energy. Supernatural. Superior to the natural. People talk about supernatural. You know, you could say that about the realms of the demonic as well. Now, superior to the natural, superior to all other things is the realm that has been given to us by the King of Kings, Christ Jesus.
Amen.
You know, people just want to, you know, and you were hearing this morning as I just began to sing by the Spirit of the Lord. You know, it's what Paul said, what are we going to do? People sometimes think, though, is everybody supposed to speak in tongues all at once in church? Absolutely. Absolutely. If you don't understand that, I just published a little booklet. You can read about it. There is no way that you can believe something different after you read the booklet. You just have to just defy the Word of God. Because we're praying in the Spirit. Can everybody pray in the understanding all at once?
Yes.
Well, then everybody can pray in the Spirit all at once. And if everybody can't pray in the Spirit all at once, then no one can pray in the understanding all at once either. Can everybody sing all at once?
Yes.
Then everybody can, you know, the understanding, then everybody can sing all at once in the Spirit. If they can't, then it's got to be all one by one.
Right.
And everybody's out of order. So it's just ridiculous what people want to make to try to shut down what is going to ultimately result in you and I being built up, strengthened, to mature and to grow up into all the inheritance that God has given to us, entrusted to us, the fullness of the measure of the maturity of the ministry of Jesus Christ unto a fully matured man, functioning in all his works and greater works, not limited to just a small group of people in a certain generation and time. For it's for anyone who will believe these signs, these works, these miracles, these things. Which by context is reality. By context of it is, listen, by context, it is relationship with Father. It's not anything else. Because Jesus is talking about his relationship and his intimacy with the Father. It's Father that does the work in me and through me. Here, he shows us the saturation of the Word of God personified. Christ Jesus, the eternal Word. Every jot, every tittle, not one will pass away till it's fulfilled in you. We want it to be fulfilled out there. But how about being fulfilled right here?
Amen. Yes.
Think about it. Salvation brought a power on the inside of us. Establish a power of God, the power of God, the divine power of God. Treasure in this earthen vessel. So that the excellency, the power, maybe of God, not of us, so that you can walk over to your treasure. Open up the treasure of the Spirit. Open up the treasure of the new birth, the divine nature, the life of God, the authority, the power, and pull forth all that you have need of in any dimension of life, and also whatever anyone else has need of that's presented before you. True. You know, I come from a long generation of successive generation of revivalists. And the revival, you know, not only my family, but the people I grew up calling uncles and close associates with, they found out long ago that the meetings need to run 90 days to 100 days. True. I was born in Caney, somebody said, where are you born? I was born in Caney, Kansas. Somebody say, you from Kansas? No. It was a 12-week revival. And I came in the 12-week revival. Huh? Because sometimes people get their miracle the first day. Others don't get it till the 100th. Twice, two times a day in the meeting. That's where you read about it in the books. All the great healing revival, all the great signs and wonders that Mariah Woodworth Edder and John G. Lake and Wigglesworth, and you go through the list. No. You're trying to misapply it to your context. That's 2-3 meetings a day, every day, continuously. Saturation with the Word of God. Saturation with the things of God, the Spirit of God, that shuts down every doubt, every ulterior motive, every wrong thinking, every area of your life where you agreed with something that is a lie. Jesus shows us the kind of life that Father produces within our lives when we're saturated with the Word.
Amen.
Living, the living Word has been begotten in me.
Yes.
In you.
Lord.
Christ Jesus.
Yes.
Formed in me. In you.
Yes.
Christ in me.
Yes.
Christ in you. My confidence. Your confidence of glory.
Yes.
Yeltsis doesn't mean hope. I hope someday. It's a confidence. Expectation. It's a certainty.
Yes.
It's sitting on the edge of knowing.
Yes.
And then the grabbing hold of it and having it.
Amen.
True.
Yes.
My confidence of glory. He showed forth his glory when he turned the water into wine. Think about it, dear people. What Father has purposed for you and I to have and lay hold of and be and to function in. This glory, this power. To understand the height, the breadth, the length, the depth, that's not level. Those are dimensions. Dimensions are far supersede levels. Levels are linear. Dimensions are exponential or factorial. If anybody's got, for all you math guys, everybody else just remember, it's huge, it's much bigger. Much bigger. And it gets there quicker too. Eh? You get there quicker. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Power. This dimension, the height, the breadth, to know Him. And this would demand a complete and an extraordinary change of life and interest and affections. Not just some religious thing to where I want to genuflect my way into the kingdom of God. Some Pentecostal one day a week thing. Some little tokenizing of God while I find myself consumed with earthly interest. No, you've never seen heavenly. That'd be like saying you want to go ahead and dig in the gravel pit when somebody done showed you the mother load of gold. I'm just going to stay up here in the gravel. You ain't going to do that. Somebody just showed you the treasure and you're going to live like a pauper. You got all this treasure. God wants you to give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of the Lord, which only comes by the word of God. And all I'm going to do is seed you this morning. And we're going to find out whether or not you're willing to bring forth the fruit of His knowledge and the fruit of His revelation, and the fruit of His life. Reality of it is people want sensationalism. They want all these fantasies. And when you all of a sudden you bring responsibility upon people's shoulders, they scatter. Go collect themselves everywhere they can hide in some kind of just, you know, ritual. Father's calling us up to a place that's so glorious. Think about it. You and I think about the heavenly realm that I get to experience right now. And the joy that I get to experience right now as I'm growing and maturing in the things of God, the things of the Word, which then ultimately allows me to grow and mature in the things of the Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is only doing the Word. And the Word is only describing what the Holy Ghost is going to do. So if you want to have wisdom to know what God is doing so you can connect with Him, then you got to understand the Word of God and don't divert or turn away or mix it with anything else.
Amen.
Mixtures won't work. It will not work. Light will never mix with darkness. Ever. Truth can never mix with lie and you have truth. Never. God in His grace and His mercy is always there working with us. He's long-suffering. Isn't that good? Huh? And his word is like silver tried in vessels of earth. Earthen vessels. Seven times. In other words, it's tried there until it is absolutely found to be out completely pure. No matter how many times. Whatever you got to go through. Israel wouldn't hearken unto the word of God, and they wanted to mix it with their opinions. And so they wondered for 40 years until all of a sudden the word was tried as silver and earthen vessels seven times. Seven just would simply mean completed, completion, it's done. Seven times would probably do it, actually, from a theoretical sense of trying to purify silver. Seven times would pretty much get it. Three, four times, you're probably at 99.8, 99.9% already. Seven, they're going to go three, four times more than that. So the Word of God's coming to you and I, and all. Somebody said, oh, he's preaching the pure Word of God. Yeah, but by the time you hear it, it's done messed up. It's done mixed up. It's done contaminated again with you. Are you listening to me? I know people hate it when I talk like this. Somebody said, if you would just talk differently, I would come back to the meeting, but you're just rude. Yeah, because I'm going to give you shock therapy. I'm not going to tell you how wonderful you are. I'm going to tell you how wonderful He is and what He wants to do in your life to make you all this beautiful, glorious thing. And so I'm going to go through stuff. I mean, when you're getting something tried, some fire's going on. Fire's going on. Don't forget Job while the fire's going on. Got a hedge about him. I can't touch him, says Satan. I got something far better than a little old hedge. I'm baptized in the very presence of Almighty God.
Amen.
Early this morning, Kelly sent me, he wanted to show me what was going on in his crusade in Africa. And had all these people were down on the ground, you know, devils crying out. And, you know, he's praying. I know he wanted me to pray with him. So he's FaceTiming me from Africa, right? I said, man, just let him bake. They in the fire, God, just let him bake. You see why? Look, you can't even add while you're speaking to what God is doing. You've already said one time, go free in Jesus' name. That's it. Let him bake. Are you baking? I mean, come on. I guess we want to blame it on the devil. Wait, man, it's God. It's God. It's his fire burning. It isn't purifying. It isn't purifying. It's consuming. It's consuming. It's perfecting. I've already been purified. Somebody said, if you're purified, why do you need to be perfected? I'm talking about it in terms of maturation. I'm talking about it in terms of agreement, complete and total agreement. The blood took care of all the sin. Don't ever make anything. Nothing can compete with the blood. Hello. And you know, from a theological perspective, my dander gets a little bit up. Anytime I hear anybody saying anything, it causes an idea to compete with what the blood of Jesus Christ has completed. Purified by his precious blood. To now know what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth, to know the love. The kissy, huggy love. To lay your life down, love. So much saturated with love that somebody could be doing all kinds of evil things about you and you're still just like goo-goo-eyed with love. Affectionate and full of compassion for their soul and for the desperate situation of their life. Feeling what Jesus felt when he hung upon a tree, crucified there for you and me, so that we may know this realm of living. Not hearing what they're saying, but seeing what God wants to do and the change that he wants to bring. Yes. Something far bigger to you than what your ears are hearing, what your eyes are seeing. Something's raptured you, the reality of the ages. The reality of the ages. The reality of the ages that only the Word of God can establish, that you and I are going to have to be willing to be saturated with and give ourselves to. Amen. I run pretty radically in ministry. Most of you know that. Somebody said we burn the candle at both ends. The wick is gone. But I still will, you will find me in the Word. On vacation, you will find me in the meeting. Huh? I'm going to be in the church. Where's Jesus? He's in the church. Yes, somebody said, well, the church is this. The church is this. Yes. It's the local entity that is connected globally. With this assembly that by nature of the way it's defined, it was two times a day. It was two times a day. By the nature of the way it was defined, God has called you and I to go and preach the gospel, the Word of God, the declaration of the Word of God. And as we do, what happens is people respond and a miracle takes place. The miracle of salvation and transformation, a new creation arises. And then he says, I want you to make them disciples. Did you know the disciple is the most frequently used word in of a noun in the New Testament? It's found almost 1,200, 1,300 times. To make disciples. People who act, by definition, it means those who act and function and live just like Jesus, the master, my ruler. More than my rabbi, my God, amen. Who's imparted to me his life, amen. His divine power. Somebody said, oh, listen, we all got to work for a living. No, you don't. You step into this realm, God provide for you better than you could ever provide for yourself. Amen. And I say, no, you don't, in response to the context in which people would say that. I've got to go be a slave for man, give 8 to 10 hours a day doing this thing, that thing, the other thing. No, you know. God will promote you over into this wonderful life of divine provision. Where everything, your job is about ministry and there's promotion there. And then it not only is your job about ministry, Father, they take you beyond that. Amen. just keeps getting bigger and bigger. Amen. Father wants us to know what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth, to know the love of Jesus which passes knowledge. In other words, you can't intellectualize this. The Word of God shows you and you go, oh God, I want that love. And the Holy Ghost says, no problem. He calls forth floods of water in the wilderness to take this wilderness and make it the paradise of God again. Listen, from a paradise to a desolate wilderness, from a desolate wilderness to the paradise. The habitation of the Almighty, and He's not living in no shack. Are you listening to me? The habitation of the Almighty. I'm housing God the Father. I'm housing God the Son. I'm housing God the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, are you serious? Are you kidding me? No, I'm not kidding you. Yes, I'm serious. Jesus said, if you'll simply obey me, believe what I said and do it, then I, my Father and I will come and make our dwelling with you. I believe what God says. I don't need any other proofs. Oh God, if you really love me, do this. What? Look at the cross. He shows you that He really loves you. There you find all the power and the wisdom of God, because in the cross, all that display of divine glory is going to be poured out on you. Did this thing go south on me? Huh? Can you still hear me on the web? I don't want to leave anybody out. Can you still hear me? It is? Good. Can you guys hear me okay? Good. Because what I got to say changes you. It works with divine energy in you. One time? All the time. You need all the time. It's like, how many times a day are you eating? Huh? Jesus destroyed the greatest power that Satan... Just turn this up a little bit for me, because I can see that it's there, but just turn it up. Jesus destroyed the greatest efforts of Satan in hell with simply words like, man should not live by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. In other words, I'm not going with your suggestions, devil. And listen, they come at us constantly and continuously, and that's why you and I need the shield of faith so that we can quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. You're going to have to quit being constantly affected by the powers of darkness instead of continually being influenced by things that would change your mind. What you need to do is continually hear, shh, 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 shh. As fiery darts are being quenched. Amen. But it's a shield of faith. Amen. Soaked down with the water of the word. Ooh, my money, huh? My head is to look. Hallelujah. Monday is the Koro sheep lana aselikisti. Hallelujah. To know this love of Christ, which passes knowledge, to be filled with all the fullness of God. Think about it. Fullness, God. Fullness, fullness. What's going to happen when I'm allowing rivers of God, the rivers that we see flowing forth from the throne of God, that wherever it goes, you know, whether you're looking in Ezekiel 48 or Revelation 21, wherever it flows, the wilderness and that which is dead and that which is salty is brought, you know, springs to life like a garden of Eden, you know, trees that bear, you know, 12 manner of fruit all year round are growing on either side of it. Speaking of the very life and the nature and the character and the provision and the glory and the display of who God is being made manifest in you and me, there is a river that flows from the throne of God right out of my heart. Because He moved the throne room from that place called the Holies of Holies, as it were, into my very life, into my very being. This is your cure.
Yes. Amen. Yes. Amen.
To see Jesus is to hear God say, behold your cure. I'm your cure. I'm your cure for whatever problem you got.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
No. You are only going to have a problem agreeing with this simply because the experiences of your life and what you believe has dominance over what God says. And Father wants to flip that for you. But you live in a world where you're saturated with your opinion and saturated with the opinions of men and saturated with a culture that is anti-God culture. There's nothing about the United States of America culture that has anything, really much of anything to do with the kingdom of God, especially now. And we will hold on to culture, we'll hold on to opinions, we'll hold on to ideas. And then that will have dominance over what God's Word says. And Father wants to flip that for you. God, the Holy Spirit has come to speak to you and minister to you truth. And all He's going to minister to you is His Word, the Word of God. He's going to minister to you the Word of God. He's not going to minister. The Holy Spirit is not going to do anything except for what the Word of God describes and declares. And if you'll agree with Him, your miracle will take place. The provision of your life will be met. It's true. It's just true. Yes. Now, Nehemiah is able to do superly abundantly above all you can think or ask, according to the power that already exists in you. Yeah. Yeah. We're in the heavens and come down. What? That doubt and unbelief prayer. He's already done that.
Amen.
Yeah. I'm not singing that song. No. Are you listening to me? He already read the heavens come down. He didn't close them back up when he went back, when he returned. They wide open. Somebody said, I've been praying. I can't get a prayer through. It's like, heaven's breath. I'm like, what are you saying to me, preacher? Even if the heavens were brass, God dwells in you. And the whole issue is somehow the fiery trial, the good fight of faith has presented something to you that has changed your opinion of what the Lord has said. So we don't have no opinion change here. Go draw out of the power of God's Word that has been placed in you, God's Spirit that has been placed on you. But if you don't understand that the same Word that framed the heavens is the Word that is working on the inside of you, that you must agree with, that you must stand against everything that defies it, or something that says different, or some experience, or some situation, or some circumstance. Come on, people. If there's anything that God wants you to understand, is He wants you to understand how full of love He is. Amen. And with that, He wants you to understand how faithful He is. Amen. He's not a man that He should lie. If you will just believe in God, you should be established of these things. Amen. While God's Word, everything that goes on in your life, it's just for a season. It's just a season. Your life is just a season. True. Your existence is just a season. True. A guy told me the other day, 80 years old, somebody come out of the hippie culture from Northern California, Punta Arena, up in Oregon. He's telling me, time is our enemy. Burning daylight. We're going to die, kind of thing. You don't understand what I'm saying. Pretty common idea. I said, no. I said, time is your ally. It's giving you a little bit more of an opportunity to get yourself right with God.
Amen.
It's your ally. Because the biggest and most important thing is one day you and I are going to stand before Him. All I'm doing is getting ready for the greatest meeting. Somebody said, I got a meeting with the president next week. I'm going to stay over in his palace. Big deal. I wouldn't go. Unless you're going to preach the gospel. If you're going to go to try to, be accepted to be a part of the group, don't go. Because all it's going to do is conflict you, mess you up, pollute you. Huh? But if you're going with the Word of God in your mouth to see change come, the change that really is the only thing that's going to make a difference in your life and anyone else's life, a change that comes by the Word, by the living Word, a change that comes by Christ Jesus, the living Word, which is only appropriated and activated in our life by the Word. That we, I don't think anybody could say it better than Peter said it in 2 Peter chapter 1. He said, we were there in the mountain. We heard. We were there. Come on, listen to me. Yeah. I was there, Peter said. I was there in the mount of what we call transfiguration. I was there. I heard Father speak out of heaven. I was looking at Jesus, and there was Moses and Elijah. I was there. And I heard what Father said audibly. He said, this is my beloved Son. And you'd think He would just stop right there. He said, but you have a more certain word of prophecy, of declaration from God, which shines as a light in a dark place, which you do well if you take heed unto. And then He goes and He explains right there that everything that is written in the law and the prophets, the law and the prophets, which the New Testament just is an unveiling of greater revelation of all what the foundation that they laid. It's a greater revelation of the foundation. There's no contradictions here. It's just a greater revelation of the foundation that they laid. Are you listening to me? You do well if you take heed unto it as a light shining in a dark place. You know, as and I'll give you an example of this. I can't tell you for certain this is true, but I'm pretty certain that it is. And I was just feeling this by revelation this morning. As the Zohar Mamadi Avanatokobaradahaya produced the song, you know, hallelujah. You know, as Paul is preaching, declaring the word of God, and that's really pretty much how the setting is made there in Acts, I believe it's 16. And there was a man, and he saw a man who was lame, and he saw that he had faith to be made whole. And he said, turn, he said, stand upright on your feet. Now listen to this. Listen to this. I know what he was saying. I know what he was preaching. He wouldn't just stand there talking about sanctification, holiness, the holies of holies in the throne room and the three chambers of the temple. Are you listening to me? Yeah. Are you hearing me? Yeah. He's telling about what Jesus did. He was telling about the signs and the wonders and the miracles of the Messiah, the living God manifested in the flesh. How they were eyewitnesses of it. How he met Jesus on the road to Damascus, and all these things that Christ did, and all these things that was reported that he did and be absolutely true and reproduced in his life. And he said, now I want you to turn to Isaiah 35:6. Of course, they didn't have a Bible to turn to, but he's quoting it to everybody who knows the word, and that would have been in general. Most all of the Jewish people, that was part of their life. For the most part, if you were educated, that's what you were educated in. The Word of God. The Hashiva wasn't about mathematics. It was about Isaiah. Huh? It was about Ezekiel. It was about the wisdom of Daniel. Would you like to move in the wisdom of Daniel? Would you like to move in the wisdom of Joseph, who knows? He knows the dream that the Pharaoh dreamed that the Pharaoh can't even remember. Wow. And you and I want to do what with our life? What was your struggle? What was your issue? What was your problem? What was your interest? What was it you said you had need of? When God has opened up for us access in all the realms of his divine power and glory, and wants you and I to go prove that he is Almighty God, that he's raised from the dead, that he's a living, eternal King, and that you and I are to be his witness, a manifest proof of his display of power of redemption from death, brought into life out of the captivity and prison of the tyranny of Satan, into the rule of the Master, Almighty God, and we just display a union and a fellowship with them where we're doing his works and greater works. Listen, people say, well, why is it experienced? Because there isn't a lot of people who's willing to fight the good fight of faith and lay hold on this eternal life. This eternal life is defined by the life of Jesus. It's not defined by a quantity of time. It's defined by a quality of life, which results in an endless life.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. I hope nobody's feeling bad here today.
No.
Feeling like I'm just a loser. That's demonic. People are constantly, the word of God is constantly being swept up by demon spirits because of hard ground of people's lives. God's word is empowerment. God says, be holy even as I am holy. That's an empowerment. That is not a threat.
Amen.
Amen. So God says, you're righteous even as I am righteous. That's an empowerment. I mean, come on, who can be as holy as God? Who can be as holy as God? Have you ever even begin to comprehend how holy he is? How is it possible that you and I can be holy even as he's holy? It's the empowerment of his divine work of grace, redemption, that you and I embrace, that we accept, and we say, this is the way it is. Somebody said, oh, it's name it and claim it. Oh, it's bigger than that. It's agreement with Almighty God. That just sounds like the threats and harassments of demon spirits to me. Come here and take your head. Feed your flesh to the fowls of the air and the beasts of the field today. Who is this uncircumcised thing that would defy the word of God and the armies of the Lord? Come on, people. God wants us to have some holy zeal on the inside. He wants you to have some zeal about his house and his temple. He wants you to get rid of the money changers and all the merchandising and all the other things that go along with the enterprises of men in the 21st century and give yourself completely over to him. is God who gives us all things freely to enjoy. If he spared not his own son, but offered him up for the sins of us all, how shall he not also by him freely give us everything? Amen. All things, not some things, everything. You're just going to have to get violent about it. You're going to have to become valiant about it. Faith never takes no for an answer. And it worships. Can you hear me? Just make a study between the difference between why a Syrophoenician woman, a woman from the tribe of Jezebel, was able to have great faith when the disciples just had little faith to no faith. They left everything, but they still didn't get it. They were just constantly trying to figure it out in their head. But a woman was desperate, said, I've got to lay hold on the power of God. And her encounter with God, which maybe an hour or 2 hours, resulted in Jesus Christ altering the conditions of the covenant to meet her need. I said altering the conditions of the covenant, as though it was altering the very will of God to meet her need. I'm not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. I can't give you the children's bread. I don't need a whole slice, just give me a crumb. He says, this is great faith. She's not taking no for an answer. You listen over to me, because I'm telling you right now, all the things around you and circumstances and situations and experiences trying to threaten you and change the word of God on the inside of you, and God wants it to be purified in you. Amen. In other words, there's going to be no mixture of what God said, amen, I'm going to do, and I'm going to believe it. You burn me at the stake, I'm still believing it.
Amen.
I'm still believing that I don't burn.
Amen.
Joshua's about 12 years old, 12 or 13. And of course, when they were little guys, they were in meetings all the time, because we were basically doing meetings all the time back in those days. And, you know, the Lord had given us this huge property over there in central San Diego. And, you know, there was just thousands of people coming and going, preachers from all over. Because that's what God has done. He brings apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers so that you can be perfected. So the word of God can just be that much more established in you. And the display of his power and his glory can be modeled to you so that it can be revealed through you. Which produces faith. Produces faith. The word of God produces faith. The exploits of the Holy Ghost produces faith. Hallelujah. But the word of God above everything produces faith. But praise God, the Holy Spirit comes along with the word of God and also produces faith. Because it's the fruit of the Spirit, isn't it? Amen. Are you listening to me? Am I going too long?
No.
You need all day. You need to be here until 1 in the morning. Then we're going to send you home, just get a few hours of sleep so you can go back here tomorrow.
Come on.
Till all of a sudden these things are activated in your life. I mean, Kelly said in the meeting for so long till all of a sudden he says, Pastor, I've got to go. I just feel this fire on the inside of me. I've got to go. I said, go. And now, you know, he's FaceTiming me this morning. I mean, there was at least 3,000-4,000 people in the meeting. People laying all over the, you know, all over the platform and in the altar. Come on, man. You just stay around the word of God till all of a sudden it gets activated on the inside of you. Then you go do signs, wonders, and miracles, period. Because God doesn't want the gospel preached other than with the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. Not in word only, but in demonstration of the power of God. And the word of God demonstrates the power of God, and the Spirit of God is, that's what he's doing. He's taking the word of God and he's demonstrating it. Yeah. And it's the word of God that produces faith in the hearing and in the life, and where all of a sudden, no matter what goes on, it's not going to be conflicted. It's not going to be compromised. It's not going to be mixed.
Amen.
Huh?
Yes.
Joshua's 12, 13 years old, and a battery blew up in his face. He says, in Jesus' name, I do not burn. He said, it wasn't about the event. It was about the reaction to the event. Huh? He'd been around dad and grandpa and others long enough to say, don't allow fear in for a second.
Amen.
Don't allow fear in. If you don't allow fear in, faith works. Ah. Hey, you gotta get built up in the faith, man. You gotta get yourself some weapons. You know, people talk about the weapons of our warfare, and then you say, well, can I see one? Will you tell me what it looks like? And they're like, Yeah, prayer, the weapon, the spiritual weapons of our warfare is this realm of prayer, this realm of authority, and this realm of speaking forth the word of God. It's the sword of the Spirit. The weapons of our warfare, they're not defensible only. It's the shield of faith, but it's not defensible only. It's very aggressive. Hallelujah. I got myself some darts to throw with both the right hand and the left. And you got to train to do that. Are you with me? You got to train to do that. And the Holy Ghost has come to be our trainer. Hallelujah. He's kind of train us how to how to how to how to be invincible, the untouchables.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. To live in this baptismal glory of His presence. Huh? It's tough when, you know, hydrochloric acid and hydrogen sulfate and a few other things get thrown in your eyes. It wreaks havoc on the retina and tissue. But not when you're so full of faith because you're so full of the Word and you've been in the meetings and you're saturated with the Spirit and the Word and you speak and say out in God's, by God's divine authority that He's placed within His Word. In Jesus' name, I do not burn.
Amen.
Come on.
Yes.
In obedience to God's Word, look at the miracle. You might get thrown in the fiery furnace, but you don't burn.
Amen.
You don't burn. Because suddenly discover that nothing burns, that it's not a deistic world where things just, God set in motion and just continues on without His involvement. But nothing burns unless He gives the command for it to burn.
That's what the
three Hebrew children discovered in the fiery furnace, that the flame could not kindle upon them because the flame can only consume that which God commands. The act, the cow's calf, the deer bring forth life, the lions and the young lions eat because God says so, and He makes it happen at that very moment, that the sun rises, not because of all of this physical, you know, science knowledge that we have about the way we think that the universe works, but because He commanded the sun to come forth, that's why it rises, and He commands it to set, and He spoke forth, and the clouds formed, and those are all doing this, all happening, activated by His command. And take all the suns that He created in His internal and infinite universe, which has no envelope there at all. Combine them together, and He's still brighter than them all. And you and I are being prepared to see Him face to face. The seraphims have been staring at for trillions of years, or trying to, and every time they try to take a look, they try to peek, and they go, ah! With excitement and ecstasy, not with terror or fear. Come on, people. No, it's bigger still. It's still bigger. It's still bigger, but you can't even begin to understand it until you allow the Word of God to saturate you, until you hunger and thirst after these things. And you let that which God, the Holy Spirit, has come to bring, the Spirit of wisdom and revelation. Oh, when your eyes are open, it's easy to have faith. The servant of Elijah thought he was in a terrible situation with so many up against just two of them, a great army before them, until all of a sudden his eyes were open and he recognized there weren't just two of them. That this is Father's realm. That this is His house and we knew it not. That truly the earth is filled with His glory. Well, all we can see, as it were, stuck over here in this place that Father has confined us to be in for His purposes, so that we can begin to relate to Him on a much higher realm than that which the senses would define. Oh, true. Much more to say there, but you're going to have to search it out yourself. But to have their eyes open and see that all around us is the angel of the Lord. And the horsemen thereof, the armies of God, His glory fills the earth. So he said, how can His glory fill the earth with all this disease and sickness and destruction and war? Because you're looking at the wrong thing.
That's right.
You see Him from the wrong realm. God wants to open your eyes, because as soon as you open your eyes, suddenly you go, I feel sorry for that army over there. I mean, they were the greatest army that I ever heard of, but now, poor guys, I wish I could let you know what you're getting ready to get. In the encounter, it looks like two prophets, but it's not. It's not. You know, from the natural eye, the cross looked like the greatest moment of defeat. Just absolute, just shambles and weakness and defeat. Just nothing but that. Here He is, crucified, dying on a cross. No, but in the unseen realm, He by Himself single-handedly defeated all the hordes of hell, every angel, including Lucifer himself, and all those that followed Him. He single-handedly, while men saw within the sense realm that which looked like an end and complete catastrophe and defeat, and the authority of man superseding everything that God was doing. In another realm, it was the absolutely most greatest moment of conquest that ever happened in the Amen. History of eternity. Amen. I said the Amen. History of eternity. Yeah. From everlasting to everlasting. Amen. Unto everlasting to everlasting. Amen. If you let God change the way that you see everything about what you do and the way you live. Come on. There's a crucible of faith going on right now in your people. There is a fiery trial of faith. You will never find the great exploits of God coming out of the ivory towers of men or the great assemblies of that which people agreed with. Never. It was always in the small assemblies of persecution, the small assemblies of those who were pursuing passionately to have that which God demands, which ran counter and contrary, cross-grained at culture and everything that was status quo and popular opinion within the realms of the church, not even in the realms of the world. It's a fight. And more than likely, you're going to agree with the status quo. And more than likely, you're going to go with popular opinion. And more than likely, you're going to flow with the streams of the world. But I'm telling you, if you'll let God bring you to in a place where you say, whether we live or whether we die, we're going to obey you, God. We're going to do what you said. I don't see how it's going to work out, but you said it's going to work out. So I totally agree. I with total abandonment, I consecrate myself and commit myself to that realm. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Many people, listen, so many of God's people don't give themselves to reading the Word. They don't give themselves to every meeting. There was no meeting that is redundant. There's no Holy Ghost meeting that is redundant. If you're watching me by the web, if you're not in a Holy Ghost church, get in one now. All you're going to do is be compromised and polluted with religion. It's going to be fiery darts that will consume you, ideas and concepts that will rule your opinion and your mind. You don't have the model of Pentecost. Listen to me, people. Those of you in here, maybe you need to hear that as well. Everybody in the, you need to understand. There's no playing games with God. It ain't about some kind of, you know, compromise. A little compromise is okay. God doesn't even have compromise. It doesn't even exist within His realm. Amen. People say, oh, well, you know what? You just need to learn how to compromise and get along. No. God demands total agreement. Compromise is a demon's game. Just a little bit. All I need is just a little bit. Just give me a little bit. Just give me a little room to work my lie. Because I'm going to tell you right now, the contamination of a lie is down to be 0.00000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000 Huh? Percent mixed with truth. It's a lie. Yeah. God's word is true. It's pure. His word is pure. His word is pure. His word will work out everything that he described. If it's not working, all you got to do is say, oh, Lord, let your fire burn in me.
Yes.
Oh, God, let the word. Your word is like a fire burn in me. Yes. Lord, your word is like a hammer. Pound on me. You know what I'm saying? Huh? Crushed rock makes great soil to grow grapes in. Crushed granite. Huh? Father is sowing the seed of his word and he wants it to bring forth fruit. God's word brings forth fruit. God's word brings forth his life. To bring forth his life. Should we begin there and then just leave it? No, God's word not only brings forth his life, it nurtures his life. God's word not only nurtures his life, it causes us to mature and grow, but God's word keeps us constantly separated and consecrated to the realms of his word so that we can throw off everything that would try to overthrow his word with the smallest little fiery dart, the smallest little act of compromise, the smallest little deception of a lie. The beautiful thing of it is, in God the Holy Ghost, walking in truth, being led and being guided by him, which he's leading and guiding us into the word, into all truth, is there is no deception there. There's none. There's none. But it's going to come down to whether or not, always, it's always going to come down to choices. What do you want more? You want your own thing or his thing? It's going to always come down to that. You want to be in the meeting, his meeting or your meeting? Huh? Are you hungry and thirsty for his word? That means you're hungry and thirsty for his righteousness. Are you hungry and thirsty for the church? Because the whole definition of what God is doing is defined within his church. The means by which his word is unveiled and revealed. The means by which his word is distributed and planted and tended to and watered and taken care of. Just like you would take care of the garden. It's in the midst of his church. And there must be apostles and prophets and evangelists and pastors and teachers that are speaking forth His word and modeling those things by the Holy Ghost if you're going to grow, mature, if you're going to be perfected. Otherwise, you're going to just simply be cast forth from the vine. You're going to wither. You're going to have one thing after one fiery situation, one circumstance after another coming at you. What am I going to do? I'm going to believe what Father says. Mon bestekia. I say faith is at work. I say faith is at work in your hips and in your bones. It's at work. I say that your bone, the spinal area of your bone, connects. What nature can hurt or harm, God can fix. How easy it is for God to connect everything upright. Father is constantly working great miracles and signs and wonders. Isaiah 35:6 is what Peter, this is what Paul was preaching. Hear this. The lame shall leap like a deer at play.
My.
Frolic. This is the gospel. This is the gospel. This is as the scripture says, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. This is it. This is it. It just said, when Jesus said it, He was taking that which was based, built, laid out on the foundation of the holy apostles and prophets, and He's now bringing forth the revelation of what does it look like in specific application. Isn't it about Israel? Oh, did you hear about what Israel did with the Sinai? It's like a rose blossoming. That ain't even what the scripture's talking about. God's talking about you blossoming. God's talking about your wilderness changing into a fruitful paradise. Instead of you looking like and acting like demons, you look like and act like God. Yes. Man was born in this natural birth in sin and shaped every day in iniquity by demon spirits and the tyranny of satanic rule. But one day, when you call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and you are born again, you are born in righteousness and every day shaped in holiness. Yes. By the Spirit of the living God. Yes. Woo-hoo. Come on, man. But it can't be offline. There's got to be something you want more than anything else. Amen. It's free, but it's still sacred. And unless you want it more than anything else, you can't have it. You'll pollute it. A transformed life demands a display of a different way of living. Everything else is a lie. It's false. Jesus modeled for us what it looks like. Amen. The lame shall leap like the deer at play. Yes. I love this one because I love watching the mute. I mean, it's one of the first mass evangelism crusade miracles that the Lord gave me in display was the mute speaking. I love to watch. It's a beautiful thing when a 10-year-old has never spoken, you look at mama's face. I don't have to listen to what's coming out of their mouth. Just look at mama's face. Huh? It's enough. The mute, the tongue of the mute shall sing. Think about it. The mute whose tongue has never been formed and never been, the muscles and all that belongs to, you know, the ability physiologically to do that has never been developed. But as soon as the Spirit of the Lord, as soon as this new covenant begins to spring forth, this is what God has purposed to display in the earth through you and me. That at the name of Jesus, at the proclamation of this gospel, that the mute, their tongue begins to sing. That waters flood the wilderness of people's lives. And springs of water in the desolate place. That's what Paul was, I believe that's what Paul was preaching. When he saw this man, as he's just, you know, that was lame, as he's describing, the time has come. We are now in the Messianic age. We are now in the age of the King of Kings. We are now in the age of the kingdom of God being displayed through the church and through the church alone. One day he will come and he will set up his tabernacle on another level, as it were, another display or another, well, I should say, dimension. Because the tabernacle of the Lord will be with us. And He will rule with a rod of iron and He will crush everybody. He will smash them as a potter smashes a vessel of clay that was marred. He will smash them. And that's the way he feels about his word. Not being altered. Don't add to it in your spirit. Oh, maybe you want to sit around and talk about translations and argue and fight with one another. No, it's about you. It's about you. Has the word of God been added to in you?
Amen.
Has it been diminished in you? In you. And yes, it needs to be pure and it needs to be perfect. But that's Father's job. He's going to watch over his word to hasten it. He's going to watch over his word and keep it.
Yeah.
This is word just trying to mess with Papa. Stop! Give me a break. Who do men think they are? God needs to be bigger and mightier to you than he is. The issue is, are you going to add to his word? If you add to his word, the plagues of this book will be added. It's all right. We understand what you said. We're with you, buddy. I'm with you. You're going to add to his word. The plagues will be added. You diminish in the word, your name be taken out of the book of life. Huh? The tempter who tempts has come. The tempter comes to tempt you and me, to challenge us with just some subtle action, some subtle word, some subtle suggestion, some subtle alternative. I heard people say, well, we're going to do John G. Lake's house, prayer rooms. I thought, oh my goodness, that's awesome. Because if they're going to do his prayer rooms, they're going to get his doctrine. John G. Lake was new man and no old man in it. 100% the temple of God, and Saint can't touch me. Put some plague on me. I'll show you right now. Huh? John G. Lake stepped over into the revelation of what it means to be the righteousness of God, to live out this purity and this glory and the divine nature, because Christ tabernacles in us with the house of the Holy Ghost, where the Spirit of the living God is displayed to us in inexhaustible rivers of divine grace and glory. Amen. But they, you know what? They try to do his prayer rooms without his doctrine. Won't work. His prayer rooms work because he grabbed a hold of the doctrine of God. That's why they worked. The only thing that's going to be able to rearrange the way you think, the way that you process, the way that you perceive things, is that you're going to give attendance to the Word of God. Yes. Hallelujah. Poshara. Thank you, Father, for bringing forth this mighty man of God, this mighty man of faith. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ezekiel. Man, I'll tell you right now, Ezekiel's here. John Samuel's coming. Praise God. We got a house full of new prophets. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now don't get all fussy. We're supposed to stay in the joy. You're supposed to stay over here in the joy with Grandpa. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Faith. Faith. It comes by hearing the word of God. Faith, supernatural, divine empowerment to do the works of God Almighty. Hallelujah. There's nothing blind about faith. In fact, it's spiritual sight.
Amen.
Spiritual sight. Hallelujah. We not walk not by sight, but by faith. It's spiritual seeing. I know how it's going to be.
Amen.
Do you know how it's going to be? Huh? I know how it's going to be. I'll prosper and I'll be in health. Satan, not a thing that he does will be able to touch me. No weapon formed against me will be able to prosper. I can walk in the midst of the fire and not be burned. I can walk in the midst of the sea, sink to the bottom and breathe and not drown. The flood shall not overwhelm me because God dwells in the midst of me. God, the Almighty, is my Lord. This is all I'm doing in case you don't know it. I'm not just bragging out of my own ideas. I'm bragging based upon what Father has said, and I totally agree with him. His word isn't about somebody else. His word is about me. All he did was bring out specific examples through the myriad of billions of examples that he could have brought. He brought only those highlight moments that he specifically wants to work and function in your life and in my life. And that's what the Bible is. It's Enoch waving at you and me saying, this realm really exists. Come on over. It's Moses saying, this is amazing. Come enjoy this place. It's just a prophecy, a declaration. This is a reality in God. Will you come and take your place?
Yes.
Will you come take your place?
Yes.
Can we find you in the place of the rejoicing? Can we find you in the place of the mighty giving thanks? Huh? If you've not received the Holy Ghost since you believed with the language or the utterance of the Holy Ghost, which is far more than an initial evidence. It's just the presence. It is the declaration that the Holy Ghost has brought you power and is teaching you how to function in it. Huh? Then today is the time for you to receive it. Huh? Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Satan hates it. That's why there's so much religion is against it. But relationship desires it.
Amen.
If you hunger and thirst after the Word of God, if you hunger and thirst after the things of the Spirit of God, if you hunger and thirst after the things that God has placed in the midst of the church, listen to what's supposed to be happening in the church. What's happening in the church and how is the church defined? Paul defines the church in such a radical way in many places, but just look at it in just chapter 12 and chapter 14 of 1 Corinthians chapter 12, chapter 14. There's two or three prophets sitting in the church, at least there's that many. There's apostles in the church. There's teachers in the church. There's gifts of healing. There's established work of miracles right there. It's a deposit in the church. It's active in church. It's resident in church. It's a mantle that exists within the church.
Yes.
Jesus Christ himself, the eternal word, stands in the midst of the church. With eyes, a flame of fire.
Yes, hallelujah.
Huh? With hair that's white like a glory glow. Hallelujah. Whose body looks like it's standing in the midst of fire, like it's brass lit up with a blue hot, red hot flame. Huh? And he's standing over his church, making sure that every word is pure. Every word is tried. Every word is just like God said it, because I'm going to tell you right now, that brings forth every miracle, every creative work, every action, every activity of the Holy Ghost. Holy Spirit will not mix it up with anything but truth. That's it. All he's waiting for you and I to do is to move in truth. And everywhere we're not seeing the miracles of the Holy Ghost, it's the places where truth has been compromised. And all you got to do is cry out and say, oh God, open up my eyes. Oh, Lord, I thank you for the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of you, that my eyes are able to see the inheritance that you have in me. He looks at you and he sees hundreds of thousands of souls will come in the kingdom. That's his inheritance.
Amen.
He sees in you the inheritance of the display of the power of his only begotten son, Jesus Christ. That inheritance, it's his, not our inheritance in him, his inheritance in you and me. Come on, the exceeding greatness of his power that was given to you and I, to us, that we have residing on the inside of us. When he raised up Jesus from the dead, set him at his own right hand, poured out the power of the Holy Ghost, the promise of the Father. Hallelujah. The ecstasy of fellowship. Huh? You get caught in the ecstasy of fellowship and sports will lose its sex appeal. You listen to me. And the lust of the flesh will lose its appeal. You listen to me. The lust of the flesh, the pride of life only has its sway over you because you haven't drank enough of its pleasures. Huh? Of his presence. Of his glory. Come on, man. People trying to fight sin and iniquity off the arm of flesh. Give me a break. Come behold his face. Come look unto him who's the author and finisher of your faith. Come be overwhelmed with the goodness of God. Give me a break. Satan can't stand a second. Can't hold a candle to all that Father has given. I want you to grab a hold of this thing that the Spirit of the Lord wants you to have, called thirsty. I want you to grab a hold of this wonderful opportunity that the Spirit of the Lord supplies, called hungry. If you don't know what hunger is, fast for a little while, and you need it anyways. If you don't fast and pray, you haven't understood the value of it. You haven't understood the fellowship of it. You haven't understood the meat that Jesus had to eat that they knew not of. Never understood the fellowship of it. Hallelujah. I'm not talking about the religion of it. I'm talking about the relationship of it. Hallelujah. In the mighty name of Jesus, I said the Word of God is working with divine energy in you that believe. I said, the Word of God is working with divine energy. Open up the Bible and be reminded of what you're supposed to be doing. Open up your Bible, be reminded of how you're supposed to be thinking. Then start back at Genesis 1:1 and begin to read back through Revelation 22:21. Don't get stuck in your first favorite chapter, your favorite verse, because all the Word of God is profitable for your reproof, for your development, for your perfection, for your growth, for your strength, for you to be able to move in the exploits of faith. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, I have many more things to say, but I'm going to save it for tonight. Jesus. 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 You know you can speak to a mountain? Listen to me. You know you can speak to a mountain and go out of the way? Say, well, I spoke. Well, just start hollering then. Huh? Say, you, mountain, I said, you get out of the way. And the Lord really, you know, the Lord just said it didn't take a lot of faith, just a little faith. Huh? Did he say that? Yeah, faith is a grain of mustard seed, just a small seed. You say to the mountain, nothing should be impossible for you if you believe. Believe what? His word. Huh? So, well, I believe his word. Yeah, but you know what? You got a bunch of other stuff running interference with that right now, too. A place called fear. Huh? Father, send forth the spirit of his son on the inside of you, crying out, God is my dad. You need to be convinced of that. Because when you are, fear can't work no more. Faith that works by love will begin to explode on the inside of you. He delivered us from the spirit of fear and bondage. Amen? Huh? Paul takes a little seed of faith and makes it all faith. If you have all faith so that you can move mountains. Isn't it amazing, huh? Oh, watch out, man. A little faith will produce all faith. It's true. Hallelujah. Little faith, but your faith will increase more and more. As you give yourself to the assembly, as you give yourself to the word, your faith will increase more and more. As you give yourself to the love of God and the display of this nature of God and the character of God. Hallelujah. Because Father has given us the opportunity to develop in all of the splendor of his character, and people act like that it's not of any value. That somehow that the commodity of the demonic nature has some kind of interest in their life. You need to drink. You need to see. You need to taste and see. Your eyes need to be open. Hallelujah. People like to sing about being history makers, but come on, come on, come on. It's a different thing altogether to stand up against all the wiles and the tricks of the devil. Amen. To be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. Think about this. There's two ways to understand it, and I'm going to close with this. There's two ways to understand it. I can be strong just thinking about his strength and his power and his might. But to do that, you're going to have to start saying, God, you're El Elyon, you're God Almighty. Oh, God, you're El Shaddai, you're the sovereign master of the universe. You decree a thing, and as it established, you speak a thing, and it comes to pass. What have you decreed over me? What have you spoke over me? You are the one who is everlasting to everlasting. You are the one, you are God, and there is none beside you. What is it that you have purposed for my life? You begin to talk to him like this. Begin to extol him. You begin to praise him for who he is. You begin to understand this wonderful work of divine grace. Right now, Christ Jesus is calling you. He wants to change things that you've been believing. Mm-hmm. He wants to change things that you've been thinking. He wants to change every dimension in the display of your life. The powers of darkness that have come to steal from you. Because that's... Satan comes to kill, steal, and destroy. Fundamentally, his focus is the Word of God. He wants to kill, steal, and destroy. But Jesus Christ has come to give you an extraordinary life. But the other way that you think about this is, finally, brethren, you be strong because you are vested with and empowered with and parted the strength of the Lord and the power of His might. Either way, that's huge. In fact, one plays off the other. As I think about how strong, how mighty, and how powerful He is. Huh? I become strong and strength. But it's like an empowerment. Wait a minute. I could never believe. I could be strong just knowing, well, God, You're able. You say, yeah, I am able. And I've enabled You. Amen. To be my witness. To stand in my stead. Son of man, what do you think we should do? Well, I think that you should right now do these exploits that only you can do. And heal and save and deliver. In Jesus' name. Brandy. Whatever need you have, watching by the web, face stream, YouTube. Really, actually, the congregation is actually pretty big here today, believe me. Just because of the real purpose and reason for having internet. And you're having all this technology to display the gospel. Because I get to preach in China today. I get to preach in Nepal and so many different places. But we're still going to go. We're still going to go there with the word. We're still going to go there with the display of the power of God. Of course, there is no limit to, there is no distance for the effectiveness of prayer. People watch on the web and demons go out of them. I get people testify of how that they were sitting watching on the web and addicted to drugs, addicted to alcohol. Immediately they set free. Just listening to the meeting, hungry for the word. Somebody said, where can I go to a church that's just going to push me to have all that Christ Jesus has supplied to me and have all the activity of the Holy Ghost is described in 1 Corinthians 12 and 14, which I don't have time to go into. There's a display of power, the resident power, the mantle of God that is resident here in the midst of the church where you and I are supposed to be trained, where He teaches our hands to war, huh? Our fingers to war. Amen. That a bow of iron is broken with our arm. We get so strong, we go to pick up the bow, you know? We don't even know our own strength, huh? We go get so strong, pick up the bow, we break the thing, and give me something stronger. Iron ain't good enough. Pretty radical, eh? Strong, the strength of the Lord and the power of His might. Taking to yourself the whole armor of God. His divine power, His divine ability, what He stands in. Because you wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against spiritual wickedness. And Father, His purpose that you and I become undefeated, untouchables. We know that everyone who is born of God does not sin. Keeps himself and the wicked one cannot touch them. Today in a modern society in the 21st century, we have to say, they knew. I know. Do you know? To grab a hold of the strength of the Lord and power of mind, to find the beauty of what it means to live out the life of the Holy Ghost instead of some demon spirit, to allow the display and the activity of God being manifested in my life instead of the display and the activity of some demon power. Amen. I'm going to deal real quickly with this one thing because it's a stronghold and I can feel the thing. And so I want to explain it to you like this. Satan loves to watch men destroy themselves through demonic activity. And what he does is all of his desires that he puts in men are the same thing. So people literally think about this. Come here, bring her here. I need her. It's a language that is common to all nationalities and cultures. When the baby cries, it says, Pastor, please pray for me. Is it Japanese baby cry? Korean baby cry? Nepali baby cry? Kashmirian baby cry? Touch. Father, I thank you if you take this baby, you make this baby perfectly whole. Where's the mom? Where's the mom? Okay, so come bring. See how the Lord does it? You've been wanting me to dedicate the baby. Look how the Lord does it. because you know I got to have a thanks. Thank you, Jesus, for the mom. It's so wonderful, listen, for babies not to be committed to foster care, that there are people who are willing to adopt them. Thank you, Karen. Because the most important thing to display the power of God is His love. You know, the church cries out against abortion, and we should. And if there's any true righteous agenda, if there were any true righteous agenda within any political administration, you know what they would do? They would immediately stop abortion. A description that there is none. They're only pursuing their own money interest. You would stop abortion immediately. The murder of over 65 million. But you know, as soon as that happens, we're all going to have to start adopting. And I know of no greater way to reach the lost than to adopt them. Are you with me? Are you listening? Wow, that sounds divine to me. You know, it sounds like a divine plan. Hey, baby. Now, in the name of Jesus, this old infection gets out of baby's lungs. And let me tell you something. Let me tell you something, sweetie. You're going to be so bright and intelligent. And there will be no effect. Listen, I see it. I see it right now. I see it. I can see it. I see it. Bright eyes. Yes. Yes. No effects of alcoholism. No effects of drug addiction. None. Oh, no, baby. You can't even know anything about it. Your mom's never going to tell you. All you're going to ever know is that you just came into this life through the means of God's good pleasure. Hallelujah. There's not a baby on the universe, in the earth that is an accident. It is impossible for there to be a baby unless God's involved. True. Satan just doesn't have that realm. And so I said, well, it was lust, it was done under this or done under that. That doesn't in any way revoke the fact that only Father can give life. So Lord, will you just dedicate these babies right now? You want, let me just, Lord Jesus, touch baby. Remind me of her name. Huh? Hope? Hope Elizabeth. Hope Elizabeth. Now is that the name you gave her, or is that the name she's born with? This name you gave her? Okay. Jacob did? Hope. Thank you, Father. Lord, we thank you for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. We thank you for your love and your goodness and your mercy. We thank you for the deliverance of these babies. And we pray in the name of Jesus Christ that all the days of their life, all they will know is your presence. They'll never know themselves given over to a demonic realm or the influences of the demonic. But to Karen, raise them in your knowledge and in awe of you. Yara is a Hebrew word. We pronounce it, we say fear, and it is fine to say fear because it's many applications of being deathly scared, afraid. But mostly in application of Father Yara is to be like the seraphim. Ah! In awe. Be in awe and sin not. Be Yara and sin not. Huh? Whew. No chatat, or sin, no chatat, sin in this place of just being in awe, looking at Him. In the meetings, if we can get people to behold God, everybody gets saved, everybody gets healed. So much religion, it runs interference in the Western society because everybody, oh, I'm a Catholic, or oh, I'm a Baptist, or oh, I'm a Pentecostal, or I'm a this, or oh, I'm a that. And it's blockaded them from beholding the beauty and the splendor of heaven. Thank you, Jesus. You feeling good, baby? I think you are. You're trade. And this baby?
Malachi James.
Huh?
Malachi James.
You know, in baby, Malachi. Mm-hmm. Malachi, Baba. Mr. Malachi. You know, in understanding, when we dedicate babies, I suppose this is very, very important to understand this. The model of it is Hannah with Samuel. And it means that you're coming up and you're going to give your babies over to the church for the church to raise them. I like to always remind people of that because they're going, wait, what? I thought we were like going to get sprinkled, you know, and you're going to, somebody's going to get to be the godfather or whatever. No. The model is this. The model is Hannah with Samuel. Lord, I'm going to give them to your house. To be raised up by your house. And of course, you want a good house to raise your kids in, right? And you don't run interference with what the youth leader said or what the pastor said. You say, just learn how to obey. Learn how to submit. Something that are too terrible, that is the most evil curse words known to the world. Huh? You know that? You understand that? You with me? How you like that? What you think about that beard, huh? In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, right now, these little lungs clear up. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for blessing Malachi and blessing Hope. And that Karen and everybody comes to help Karen. These are number four, right? For adoption, four children now. How many kids are you gonna have? Father, I thank you for raising up many mothers to a fatherless society. Huh? Thank you, Lord, for raising up many mothers to a fatherless society, parentless society. And fathers too. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Sukoto lo momost. Thank you for Jesus. And Faith, you're helping, right? Come here. Now, how old was Faith when you adopted Faith? When you first got Faith? Five? And look at her, she's a Holy Ghost woman. Yeah. Signs and wonders and miracles. You tell the devil where he's got to get off and where he's got to go. Wow, come on. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, I thank you so much for strengthening faith with the divine ability to be a perfect model to her little brothers and sisters. In the name of Jesus, Lord, vindicate yourself. Prove yourself. Show that name that you've sanctified. The name of Jesus through your servant Faith. What a name. Amen. Isn't that great? Isn't that great? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Feeling better, aren't you, buddy? Thank you. There's so many children to reach. So many children to reach. People standing around not realizing what they can do. There are right now in San Diego, let's just take central San Diego for right now. There's probably somewhere just roughly 20, 30,000 kids at home in a living room somewhere between the ages of 2 years old and 10 years old, no parents around. Their parents are heroin addicts or alcoholics or just gang members or whatever, and there's no one taking care of them. And all that's gotta happen is somebody's gotta pay the price, lay down their life. You know, I think it was within inside of 3 months, I think we, something like over 1,000 kids came through the ministry when we were downtown. And we just didn't have the human resources. Always human resource limited. People say, what can I do? They're dreaming of something else. Look all around you, the harvest. But to land her into the harvest, signs and wonders and miracles are essential. Because that's what Jesus did. They all came to be healed. And he healed them of all, every kind of disease and sicknesses, right? Right? And he said, pray that the Lord of the harvest raise up laborers. And he's the model laborer. He doesn't want other kind of laborers. When I was first sent to China by house church leaders, I thought, man, if I get to China and I find a bunch of deadhead religion with 1.3 billion people, I mean, what on earth can you even do? I got there and saw a great and mighty move of the Holy Ghost. I discovered China doesn't need Western missionaries. They do them fine on their own. Signs, wonders, and miracles. That's why there's so many. There's close to 300 million Holy Ghost-filled Chinese. The church is huge. Signs and wonders and miracles just want the life of Jesus, ministry of Jesus, like the days of Jesus. Now, they used to say in China, oh God, you can do in China what you do in America. They used to say in Africa, oh God, you can do in Africa what you do in America. Now we're saying, oh God, you can do in America what you're doing in Africa. Oh God, you can do in America what you're doing in China. Thank you for the anointing. Now listen, don't fret or concern yourself with any need or seeming lack, because your good shepherd, your master, your Savior, Christ Jesus, is leading you, and you shall not lack, you shall not want. And so instead of saying, oh, no, we need this, or no, we need that, just say, Father, I thank you for providing. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Watch what God will do. And watch his Father. He'll put things together in his time. It won't be your time sometimes. It's always great when God's on our time schedule. We're like, we can really praise him when he's on our time schedule. You know what I'm saying? Right? It just doesn't seem right when we have to be on his. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay? Speak faith. Like never before, Karen, like never before, you will speak faith. In the name of Jesus, Karen, you house of the living God, you servant of the Most High, speak faith like never before. Great confidence, great boldness, worship, praise, take no for an answer. Never take no for an answer. Right? No more taking no for an answer. Never take no for an answer. In Jesus' name. Amen. Everybody stand with me. Stand. Stand upright on your feet. Stand upright on your feet. Strengthen the feeble knees. Lift up the hands that hang down. Lest that which is lame turn you out the way. Hallelujah. Today, if you have not surrendered your life over to the one, the captain of our salvation, who invaded the earth with the armies of heaven to redeem you from your enemy that had enslaved you, right now, today, he will come to you if you call upon him. He'll deliver you. He'll change everything about your life, and you've got to agree with the change. You've got to agree with it. He'd take you from death to life, from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to his power. All you've got to do is call upon his name. There is no name greater than his name, more powerful than his name. At his name, every power of hell must submit, must flee, must go. Today, Satan is control of your life unless you've been born again. Unless you called upon the one who would come and deliver you and save you out of the prison that you're in. If you want a change of life, if you no longer want to live under the rule of sin and death, Christ Jesus the Savior, Christ Jesus the Redeemer, he's knocking at the door of your heart. If you'll open up your heart to him, in the name of Jesus, every mind-blinding spirit that belongs to religion and belongs to the world, I break the power of it right now so that you can go free. Today, right now, this moment in time, God wants to meet you. God wants to meet you. Right there at the place of your heart and of your affections and of your desire. He wants to deliver you. And I'm going to give you a warning. If you don't do it his way, you'll spend eternity in a place called the Lake of Fire. And that's just the way it is. And God's not willing that any would perish. But if you, of your own choosing, want to walk in sin and want to walk in ungodliness and want to defy and deny God's goodness and grace, you will spend eternity with Satan, and his doom and his destiny is already sealed. That's what Jesus did at Calvary's cross. He will forever be bound in the lake of fire, a place of torment before the presence of God forever and forever.
Amen.
I advise you to let God the Holy Ghost show you that life is better than death, that light is better than darkness, that the ways of righteousness is far better than the ways of unrighteousness. The goodness of God is so much better than the badness of this world.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Oh, the pleasures that are in His presence. Oh, the goodness of God that Father wants to pour out upon you. He'll heal all your diseases. He'll cleanse all of your sins and your iniquity. And they will be never brought into account. They'll be remembered no more. One act of sin is a high treason against God Almighty, and it carries with it an eternity called death, a penalty called death. But because of God's goodness and because of God's grace, the obedience of one has outdone the disobedience of Adam. The obedience of one, Christ Jesus, has worked a work of grace so that every sin would be erased. Would you let Him erase your sin right now? Will you let Jesus Christ come and take His blood and apply it to your life so Satan has no claim on you?
Yes.
Today you stand at the crossroads. Many people that are listening to me stand at the crossroads of choosing life to live or choosing death to be destroyed. And then there's that crucial. This isn't some religious thing where you're signing up to be a part of a religious club. This is about your soul. There's many people that I've ministered to and reached to, and I was the last one they ever heard before they went out into eternity. They thought they were going to live for a long, long time. Some people think acting like they're going to live forever. The fool has said in his heart that there is no God. Well, I'm going to tell you right now, a fool also is the one who acts like that they're not going to have to give an account to God. Today is a day of salvation. Today God wants to deliver you. He wants to change you. He wants to fill you with peace and joy and love. He wants to comfort you with His presence and His goodness. He wants to supply all that you have need of according to His riches and glory. He wants to be the good shepherd that leads you in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. He wants to teach you how to choose that which is good and refuse that which is evil instead of having it the other way around. He wants to teach you how to live in peace with all those around you, how to love all men, how to just live the good life, the extraordinary life. And I want to make sure that everybody that's listening to me, whether you're standing here right now or listening by web or YouTube or whatever it is, that you have the opportunity. And it doesn't matter where you're at right now. All you got to do is say, Jesus, come help me. Jesus, come deliver me. I don't want to live this life anymore. Jesus is for those who are done with the life that is in this world. If you still like the life that is in this world, I'm going to tell you right now, it's going to give you nothing. It's going to provide nothing for you. But I know that Christ Jesus is dealing with many people's hearts right now. You don't want the things that are in this world anymore. You don't want your life that is in this world. You're ready for the life that God has for you, provided for you in Christ Jesus. All you have to do, it's just this simple. It's this easy. Say, Jesus, come save me. Come deliver me. Come rescue me. Come change me. Come make me a new creation. Come change my heart. Come change my spirit. Come work this miracle of salvation in my life right now. It's just that simple. And you don't even have to use that many words. You just say, I want you now. Come get me. In fact, He sees your heart and He'll call before you answer. Hallelujah. So you say, I don't even know what to pray. I don't even know what words to say. He sees that heart. You just say, Jesus, come save me. Come deliver me now. Just say that. Say, Jesus,
Jesus,
come save me.
Come
deliver me now. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody in this place, if you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost, just as they were on the day of Pentecost, the baptizer is here. It's Jesus' heavenly ministry. If you're watching by web right now or YouTube, look, the baptizer is right where you're at right now. He'll come baptize you. He'll baptize you in the glory of heaven. He'll baptize you in the presence and the glory of the Holy Ghost. And you begin the language of the Holy Spirit, the way God the Holy Spirit speaks will begin to speak through you. It's not words created by you, but created by the Holy Ghost himself. So he can train you how to talk and think and act on a whole nother level of power and faith and exploits. So just lift your hands towards heaven, just receive whatever you have need of. Whatever you have need of. Sickness in your body. If it's any kind of torment in your mind, any kind of unrest in your spirit, God, Christ Jesus, the Savior, is here to save you and heal you right now. Receive. Right now. Right now. Right now. You receive divine strength. Receive divine strength. Right now. Receive divine strength right now.
God is raining in this place right now. I smell it. I smell rain. And it's everywhere. And he's calling you guys. And he wants you to step out whatever you have need of. He wants you to step out and receive it right now.
Step out from the realm of what you know into the realms of what he shows. Step out right now. Step out right now from the realm of your limitation into the vast expanse of God's goodness and glory. Step out right now and receive whatever you have need of. Maybe it's a financial need. God supplies it right now, and he's going to do it by a miracle of faith. And I'm going to tell you right now, your bank account might look the same, but the confidence and the faith inside of your heart will change all of that. I'm going to tell you, and everything will have to adjust according to that which faith declares. If it's in your body right now, step out. If it's in your thinking realm, your mind, step out. Lay hold on what God has delivered. It truly, it's raining here. His presence saturates the place. The man of Galilee is passing by. Reach out and touch him now. Reach out and touch him now. Say, Jesus, Jesus, you Son of God. Jesus, the only begotten Son of God. Have mercy upon me. Have mercy upon me. Hallelujah. Reach out and touch him now. 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 Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. I want to pray for everyone who wants prayer, needs prayer. No matter what it is, spiritual, financial, physical, doesn't matter what it is. You want to surrender your life to Jesus? You need to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. You got physical problems. You got financial problems. You got some kind of spiritual problems. The enemy comes and, you know, dangles his little tricks and little lies in front of you, and you're still a taker. You still fall for his stupid tricks. And you need to understand how to walk in spiritual insight and revelation and recognize that the wages of sin is death. You don't have that wisdom yet. God will fill you with wisdom. Somebody said, I want to walk in the wisdom of Joseph. We got to start at the beginning. Choose life. You got to get smart enough to want life more than death. You know what I'm saying? You got to get smart enough to turn on the lights. Amen. And want light more than darkness. This is, and God, the Holy Ghost, is here to give you those smarts. Give you that wisdom. You have to participate with the miracle. Until the blind man believed that Jesus would open up his eyes, he would remain blind. Until the deaf man believed that Jesus would open up his ears, he would remain deaf. God has given a remedy for every situation. Financially, he says to us to give. And he promises that he will multiply it. He'll produce a harvest in those who give sparingly. And even those, you know, those who give generously, and you know, and you think about, well, maybe some people think, well, you got to give generously for to get a harvest. No, the Lord's giving, give a harvest to those who give sparingly. to participate. You got to participate with God. Let me say it to you like this. And I want you to say it with me. Say the smallest acts,
of obedience.
Say it again. The smallest acts,
of obedience.
Works the greatest miracles, of faith. I want you to say it again. Say the smallest acts, of obedience.
Works the greatest miracles,
of faith. Somebody said, can you help me understand that from a proof text? Yes, your salvation. What a small act of obedience. Call upon the name of the Lord. What a great miracle. Amen. What a great miracle of faith, eh? And having begun in the Spirit, you'll also be made perfect by the Spirit. You'll mature. He that works miracles by the Spirit, he's going to do it by how? The Word. The hearing of faith, which is the Word. I want you to get saturated. Kutana mandadeya. Hear the Lord. I want you to get 2020. God says, I want you. Here's the Spirit of the Lord says, I want you to have 2020 vision. 2 Chronicles chapter 20 and verse 20. Believe the Lord. Hallelujah. Believe Him. Believe in Him and believe what He says. Believe Him. Believe the Lord and you shall be established. That's everything. Everything that God says is yours. All things that pertain to life and godliness. Hearken unto the prophets, and so shall you prosper. So anytime you don't think you can see, you're not sure where to go, not sure where to turn, not sure what to do, just get 2020 vision. Go in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 20, and say, oh, believe the Lord. Believe the Lord. Believe the Lord and hearken to the prophets. Hallelujah. Established and prospering. So, two things I want you to do. Two acts of obedience. Two acts, simple acts of obedience. One is that I want you to give as God has commanded. You honor the Lord with your tithes. Somebody said, oh, well, that's Old Testament. No, it's before the Old Testament. Abraham did it as pre-Old Testament, so to speak. Pre-Old Covenant, okay? You with me? And you know, Father just called us to be generous, to give, because He wants to give to us. And as we give, He said, I'll cause all sufficiency to be supplied to you so that you have all sufficiency in all things. I'll call all grace, all divine ability and all that divine empowerment can give to be supplied unto you so that you have all sufficiency in all things from the all-sufficient one. And if you're not right with God, if you're right with God, let me tell you, you're certain. If you're right with God, you're certain, and you've got a change of life, you've got a change of vocabulary, you've got a change of behavior, you've got a change of desire. So if you're not certain that you're right with God, if you're not certain that from this day forward you can live the life of Christ, and you're not certain that if you were to die right now, so I don't want to just die, I want to also live. Are you with me? If you're not certain that you can live the life of Christ Jesus from this day forward, or if you're not certain if you die you'd be accepted by Him, right now God wants to establish certainty. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And all you got to do is come. It's just a simple act of obedience. If you got anything, any problem, sickness, disease, virus, affliction, bacteria, you're lame, you're deaf, you're blind, you're mute. And I don't see anybody that could possibly be actually dead. Otherwise, we would call for the dead. Huh? Because that's what I went into a funeral home just recently. And they said, well, we heard that you were coming over to view the body. I said, I come over to view the body. We heard you were coming between 1 and 2 o'clock and view the body. I said, I come over to view the body. I came over here to raise the dead. And I don't want no hour of time. I'm going to be with this body all day if it's what it takes. And they're looking at me like big eyes. And they're going, what on earth is wrong with this guy? This guy's got some serious issues, right? He wants to hang out with a dead body all day. I said, no. Because they're walking. I could see them walking. They're talking between themselves, going, looking back at me. I said, hey, guys, come back. Come here. God, I'm a preacher of the gospel, and I know you probably know about church, and this may be strange to you, but I've been commanded by the Lord Jesus Christ to raise the dead. That's what I do. And they're like, what on earth? I thought that was like 2,000 years ago. No, it's right now. It's right this moment in time. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hey, I'm glad to see you two standing here. What's your name? ¿Cómo se llama? Ah, mucho gusto. Gladys, bless you. So what's up? You want to give your life to Jesus? What's wrong with your leg, man? Your back? Huh? What happened?
He had an accident at work with his...
In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. In nombre de Jesucristo. Ahora mismo. This knee? Is it the knee or the back?
The knee.
It's healed.
Yes, sana.
Yes, sana?
Sana.
Sana. Yeah?
Es sana.
Es sana? ¿Cómo se dice?
Es
healed?
Sana.
Es sana. En nombre de Jesucristo. Hallelujah. Have you given your heart to Jesus? Give your heart to Jesus? You turn your life over to God. Turn it over to Him. Where you become that person who lives His life. Where Christ Jesus lives in you. Huh? God make a preacher out of you. A radical Holy Ghost preacher. Yeah? 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 Hallelujah. You want to be blessed? To live in blessings? Everything that you have need of? All the days of your life? God wants to do more than that for you. He wants to bless you now and in through eternity. True. You have children? Huh? You married, right?
Yes.
Esposa?
Sí.
Esposa?
Sí.
Sí. Two children?
Dos.
Dos children?
Yes, two boys.
Those boys are going to be blessed if you'll just simply let Jesus come and be your master. From this day forward, let the Holy Spirit, Espíritu Santo, come and rule your life. In the name of, rule your life. Listen, He provide everything you need. Look at me. Look at me. He will provide everything that you have. He will bless you. He will be your defender. Your protector. He'll fill your heart with joy and gladness all the days of your life. Goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life. And you will dwell in the house of the Lord. Amazing, eh? This is true. This is true. This is true. From this day forward, in the name of Jesus Christ, you changed man. You changed woman. We take the blood of Jesus Christ and we apply it to your life, to your spirit, to your soul, to your body, to your spirit, your soul. So that everything of death, everything of Satan, everything of darkness, everything of a curse, everything that belongs to the realms of the world, removed, and you go free. Libertad. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And that knee strengthens right now. That knee strengthens. That knee strengthens right now. That knee strengthens right now. The inflammation goes out of it. You got some kind of cup on it. What happened? Tell me what happened.
Me doblé la rodilla en el trabajo.
No, pero cómo? Todo lo que pasó. Ibas cargando.
Sí, iba cargando.
He was carrying. He used to work at a nursery.
Okay.
He was carrying.
Uh-huh.
Sí, pisé un borde.
So he misstepped.
Uh-huh.
And then he twisted.
Right.
And so the knee just went to the side.
Okay. How long ago did it happen?
¿Hace cuánto tiempo pasó?
Meses.
10 months.
10 months ago? Well, it heals now in the name of Jesus. You start bending it. Look at me. You start bending it. You start bending it. And you say this. You say, in Jesus' name, knee be strong. In Jesus' name, knee be strong. In Jesus' name, knee be strong. Hallelujah. And you start putting pressure on it and you start walking it. You start walking. You don't worry about no fear that you're going to injure it or you're going to hurt it or it's going to slip out of place again or you're going to make things worse or whatever. This thing is healed. It's healed. It's healed. Just like God has healed your heart and your spirit, it's healed. And bless your two boys. What's your boys' names?
Riquelmer y Jeff.
Jeff and
Riquelmer.
Jeff and?
Riquelmer.
Riquelmer?
Riquelmer.
That's a tough one. That's new for me. Riquelmer. Riquelmer. I didn't say it right. Gringo, eh? Riquelmer. Hallelujah. Blessing on Riquelmer. And blessing upon Jeff. Hallelujah. Prasakatara and Vishiatana. Scripture says, and Jesus breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Ghost. Receive. Right out of your belly flows. Listen, you're healed. Your knee's healed. Your knee's healed. I promise you. I promise you. Savior.
Salvador.
Jesus Christ
Jesucristo
is also healer.
También es el sanador.
Hallelujah. And you healed.
Y eres sano.
And you changed.
Cambiado.
Now you need to be in church. Got to be in the church.
Got
to have the word. Saturated in the word. Are they coming to your meeting up in Escondido? Ah. Oh. Oh, good.
And the boys.
And the boys. Yes. Praise God. Good preacher?
Good preacher?
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Mongambra satara da kishti yatara da masasta. Manda da kasista. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I thank you for your blessing upon this whole family. That they are going to be a living testimony of what it means for two people with two sons to turn their lives completely over to you. I break off every stronghold, every lie of the enemy, every wrong behavior, to every evil thing. There shall be no more immorality. There should be no more wrongdoings. No more. But from this day forward, you're going to learn how to walk like God. How to walk in the ways of life. In Jesus' name. Hello. What is your name?
LaShonda.
Father, I thank you that your blessing and your working of your power is already all over LaShonda. In the name of Jesus, Father, takes things that Satan tried to destroy and he breaks the yoke of the enemy of our soul and he brings life. He brings resurrection life. LaShonda, what do you want Jesus to do?
Keep our family together.
Okay, what's happening? Tell me what's going on. Oh, is that right?
We're struggling.
Okay.
To keep a roof over our head.
Okay. How many children do you have?
Three.
You have three children. Have you turned your life over to Jesus? This change has got to come.
Yeah.
This change has got to come. You can't be just doing whatever you got to do to survive. You can't be doing that. Because Father wants to provide for you everything that you need. But you got to obey Him. You got to say, okay, whether we live or die, we're going to obey you, Lord. Are you willing to do this? Are you willing to cut off everything that is contrary to the ways of God? Are you willing? Are you willing? Then in the name of Jesus Christ, I prophesy supernatural provision to you and radical change. But it's not going to come by you looking to men. It's going to come because you're going to turn your heart and your affections completely over to Him. From this day forward, wholeness comes to you, Lissandra. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Lift your hands towards heaven. I say change and wholeness comes to you, Lord. Wholeness. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Spirit of the Lord and the blood of Jesus Christ goes all the way back through the history of your life, every day, every week, every month, every year. And He brings His healing power into your spirit and soul. Now, every yoke of the enemy broken off of you, Lissandra. Every claim of hell and of death broken off of you now. In Jesus' name. If you will obey God, if from this day forward you will resign yourself to follow through in your commitment to God, I command a blessing on you. I command a blessing on you. And everything that has ruined your life and everything that has cursed your life will no longer have influence over you or power over you. I break off the yoke in Jesus' name. I break it off of you now in Jesus' name. Your foul spirit of hell. Your foul spirit of hell that has tried to work death and destruction upon Lissandra and her family. No more. No more. No more. I want you to lay a hand right there on your chest. Lay your hand right there on your chest. Lay there. He goes deep into your heart right now and He heals you. He does. Right there, deep into your heart, deep into your affections, deep into your desires and what you want. He goes in there and He heals you right now. Puts His desires there. His wants right there. Right there. He fills you and changes you right now. Now you listen to me. Lissandra, I speak into your spirit and your life a supernatural provision and a supernatural supply. It comes to you now. It's going to shock you. It's going to be supernatural. It's going to shock you. And do not allow your heart to be turned away from the one who works this miracle for you. But rather, let it then cause you that much more surrender. For if you will, the supply will not end. If you will, the supply... Lissandra! If you will, the supply will not end. The supply will not end. But there will be one miracle after the next, one provision after the next. And your daughters and your son will only know heaven's provision. From this day forward, the yokes on that have been attached to their life will be broken also. Lissandra, do you believe what I'm saying to you is true? I tell you, it's true. It's true. It's true, dear. Come, come here. Come here, give me a head. Come here. The Lord just wants to love on you. He loves you so much. He does. He wants to show you holy, pure love. Yep. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. He heals the brokenhearted. He sets the captives free. He makes the lame to walk again. And He causes the blind to see. He's able. He is able. Bless you, dear. I kambrosto kost. What's up?
I'm getting a lot of headaches. Migraine headaches.
No more. No más. In nombre de Cristo. Ahora mismo. No más.
Look. Look at this. I'll break the thing off of you. It shall not be ever again. It shall not be.